ensure that the welfare of the, any of the refugees that may be resettled there at that facility would be met.
Can you just come back, sorry, just come back. The people who are going there, Chief, will come into St Adams. So what I'm saying is, there may be work for Suzanne to do.
It's not just about the support we give to Syrian resettlement programme in our country. It's other people from other war-torn parts of the world, and in particular, the Prince's Trust down the past few months on various programmes. We've had asylum seekers from various countries, and they've been young men and young women. No older than 20 years of age, who fled the countries for fear of their lives, and have ended up here in headquarters at the presentation of the Prince's Trust, having completed the 12-week successful programme. So that's been a huge success, but one of the things that comes on to me is, and there were some members of the authority at one of the latest presentations, and it was a young man of 19 who the first thing he did was put on the screen a picture of his hometown, bombed, his home wasn't, he couldn't identify his home, he didn't know whether his family was still alive, and he came and ended up on the Prince's Trust, and he travelled through 10 countries from Syria to get here, and to see that young man. And this is not someone who's, you know, these people are not coming here to sponge off the country and claim benefits. This young man was actually at university training to be a pharmacist and wanted to put something back into his own country with his own people. And he was the first one in that particular area in his city or whatever, certainly from his own family, who'd gone to university. And he ended up on the Prince's Trust. But to see that young man when he was offered, when he was given on the night a certificate to say he completed the Prince's Trust, and he had a grin from ear to ear, could speak very little English, but got on so well with the other members of the Prince's Trust group that he was a part of for 12 weeks. And they all hugged one another and said, what a fantastic time we had. It was a difficult time, language barriers, etc. But that young man had been welcomed into the country, into our area, and certainly being welcomed into Merseyside Fire Rescue Service. And it's a fantastic tribute, and I've got to say that, because there's one young man whose life we have saved and helped. Thanks, Chair.
Years, it's anniversary this year. service delivery plan proposed in November 2016.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report is to request that members scrutinise performance across the report period and to approve the service delivery plan update. Any members who attend the audit and scrutiny subcommittee will be familiar with the layout of this report. An explanation of the planning process is set out in paragraphs 3 to 4 on page 31, which is followed by an explanation of how performance indicators are developed and reviewed. That's in paragraphs 6 to 10, which is on page 32. Substantive detail for members to consider is contained within the appendix to the report, which is at pages 35 through to 69. An update on progress against each of the functional objectives is set out at pages 36 to 52. And then graphs detailing performance against each of the benchmark indicators is set out at pages 58 to 69. The colour code in the top right hand corner of each graph gives an indication of performance relative to target, i.e. the red, amber or green. If I can ask members for you to turn to page 65, please, I can highlight one area where performance is not on target, which is for special service calls attended, and then below that is for road traffic collisions attended. The title of the table is at the bottom of the page on the right-hand side of the table. Gives an explanation as to reasons why the two indicators are on target. So we'll take the first one. The overall number of special service calls, we make reference in there to the fact that we are 208 more incidents than for the same period in 2015. However, we are now undertaking emergency medical response, which is the response to cardiac arrest emergencies, along with the North West Ambulance Service, rather, and that accounts for 160 incidents. You can see there why there is a reason for the variation. It doesn't account for the full variation. And then there's some other increases there around things like affecting entry on behalf of the ambulance service and the police service, both of which have seen increases in the overall volume of courses. And then there's other examples of special service calls, which in essence is this is the rescue of persons or indeed animals on some occasions for incidents other than fires, which is as the chair made reference to earlier on. It is a very broad spectrum of incidents that the fire rescue service responds to, which you are aware. The other area where we're on the target is for the total number of false alarms. That's page 66, you can see in the bottom right hand corner. And the variation there, the reason for us exceeding the target is down to the number of responses to automatic fire alarms in sheltered accommodation. You appreciate our automatic fire alarm policy, and we still respond under the full emergency response to any domestic dwelling and sheltered accommodation falls within that categorisation. It is fair to say, members, we are unlikely to manage these numbers down significantly, simply because we are always going to get those incidents occurring, and we are always going to respond to them, because this is not commercial premises, this is domestic dwellings. Appreciate there's quite a lot of information contained there within the appendix. There's definitely a lot of information for you to digest, so I'll pause at that point, Chair, to take any questions that members might have. Should appreciate within the protection team. So this is the lads, the fire safety officers whose remit under which this falls. we do engage with the, I suppose, use the term serial offenders, but in essence that is what we're talking about here. But the, because there is such a large number, this is not like, for example, engaging with a commercial premise that has particularly high levels of unwanted fire signals due to poor management practices. This is dealing with ostensibly what are single private dwellings within an overall managed facility. And then you walk back into it's this, this is people that you're dealing with, you've got to try and deal with the individuals, trying to educate people and such like, which clearly you do, which then sort of brings this more from protection led to fire safety, more so then into prevention. It's the, there's our advocacy teams, and clearly we do that, but the fact remains, because of the very nature of these premises, i.e. they have hardwired fire detection signals which are linked into alarm centres. If someone's smoke alarm goes off at home when they are, as a result of them cooking, then we are not going to get turned out to that, because we're never going to get made aware of it unless of course the occupier fucking said, as in these circumstances, we do get made aware of it, and because these are domestic premises, and people that we are going to respond to them. So I think after just got to set an expectation, I'm thinking that because it's very unlikely that we're going to significantly manage these down. Is the only way you can do that is to say, well, we're not going unless we get a backup call to confirm a fire. And of course, that will delay then the response, and we're not going to do that. It's ultimately, it is not the. It is not the responsibility of the scheme providers to manage what happens beyond the threshold of the individual's private dwelling. It is a matter for them, and it's just the reality. We are unlikely to have that huge impact on these units. But clearly, one stop is trying to educate, but we just have to be realistic.
Item 8, which is the Chief Fire Officers Association Training Programme. Chief?
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report is to update members on the progress made by CFOA on its reform programme. The background of the report set out in paragraph 3, which is on page 71. In simple terms, CFOA was recognised very early on following the move of the Fire Rescue Service from DCLG back into the Home Office that it needed to reform much in the same way as the police did in their transition from what was formerly the Association of Chief Police Officers, ACFO, across to what is now the National Police Chiefs Council, the NPCC. The role of CFO and the benefits that it delivers to Fire Rescue Authorities now and indeed will continue to deliver through the reform programme is set out at paragraph 3, which is on pages 71-72. The drivers for reform are set out in paragraph 6, which is also on page 72. The guiding principles for the reform programme are set out in paragraph 7, which is on pages 72-73. And the basis for the reform programme is set out under the heading Establishing a National Fire Chiefs Council, which is in paragraphs 9-12 of page 73. In essence, the NFCC will replace the existing Chiefs Council with coordination committees replacing what is the existing directorate structure. And just for information, members, I will chair the Operations Coordination Committee, which that sits well with our legal authority role for national resilience and how strategically in that regard. The National Fire Chiefs Council will work on a one fire rescue service, one vote principle in order to decide on any policy issues. The most significant change is the move away from having a president, which would serve the term of 1 year, to the appointment of a paid chair, which I am delighted to say is Chief Fire Officer Roy Wiltshire from Hertfordshire, who is a very close friend of this authority. The leadership of the National Fire Chiefs Council is called in detail within the report of paragraphs 13-17, which is on pages 73-74. CFOA will continue to exist as a charity and as a membership organisation. However, the current board of directors will be replaced by the board of trustees, which will be drawn from each of the Fire Rescue Service governance models. So John Roberts, the new Chief Fire Officer of West Yorkshire Fire Rescue Service, but was formerly at Merseyside, will represent the Met. So just to be clear, members of the six metropolitan fire and rescue authorities, three of the officers are from Merseyside, which is for us to have 50% coverage across the Met. Not bad, I suggest. Paragraphs 24-26 on page 75, just set out on the areas where the NFCC may deliver cashable efficiencies for the Fire Rescue Services, primarily through the development of national coordinated activities, and examples of that would be, for example, the research and development holding the procurement hall. Also referenced within the report is the coordinated response to national emergencies, which, as members are well aware, is delivered through ourselves as the lead authority for national resilience. The remainder of the body of the report covers the National Fire Chiefs Council contribution to the new inspection and standards regime and outlines the extent to which the National Fire Chiefs Council and CFO will continue to engage with partners. In summary, members, CFO has made significant progress on its reform agenda, all of which is very positive on our senior and Merseyside. I'll pause at that point and take any questions that you might have.
Just a comment just to say well done, yeah. Merseyside again. Well done, Merseyside Fire Service. Once again, leading the way.
And Dan, that's Dan taking centre stage.
Yeah.
Any other comments? Okay. Yeah, just agree with what Dan has just said. It's great to see that Dan has city.
Chair, just before I start, Chair, just welcome Councillors Blakely, Berry and Mr Spencer to be at the meeting and have a chance to say to welcome them formally before the meeting and just take that opportunity now.
Much appreciate that you come.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report then is to advise members of the decision of Wirral's Planning Committee to use planning permission for the community fire station at Sogo Massey, which would replace the existing stations of Upton West Kirby, and to note the actions taken by officers to ensure that the authority resolution over the proposed merger is delivered. Members will be well aware of the background to this issue. However, for completeness, it is set out in paragraphs 3 to 11, which is on pages 79 through to 81 of the report. The application was considered by the Planning Committee on the 15th of December. Summary of the outcomes from the committee is set out in paragraphs 12 through 26, which is on pages 81 through to 84. In accordance with the Borough Council's Code of Conduct for members and officers dealing with planning matters, the lead petitioner objecting to the planning application was offered the opportunity to address the Planning Committee in support of the petition, i.e. to speak out against the application. One of the Sogo Massey Ward Councillors spoke on behalf of the petition and advised that no representative wished to address the committee. And as a result, members, I was denied the opportunity to address the Planning Committee to explain why the application was being made and what the consequences of refusal would be on public safety. Another of the Sogo Massey Ward Councillors then addressed the Planning Committee for around 20 minutes, speaking against the application. I was also not given the opportunity to respond or indeed correct what the numerous factual inaccuracies advanced by the councillor. In the report, we'll take the opportunity to correct some of the inaccuracies for the benefit of members, and if you'll indulge me, members, I will read from the report and for the record, just to set that straight, which I think is probably necessary. So we go to paragraph 16, there's references here to Upton being a fallback location. For the avoidance of any doubt, members, Upton is absolutely not a fallback location. Right, it is the inevitable consequence of ultimately this planning application being refused. As members are well aware, we can no longer afford to staff West Kirby and Upton because of the ongoing financial challenges. Of the two stations, Upton is the key station. I'll come to that as I speak through two further aspects of the report. But the bottom line is, you only have one fire station covering West Wirral. Like, Upton is not the right place for that fire station. That would be self-evident to anyone, which is the driver for the planning application. It is to relocate Upton to better serve the all of West Wirral, which of course includes the existing West Kirby station area. Paragraph 17 covers the statements made about the detrimental impact on Arrow Park, stated on numerous occasions. The responsibility for fire safety at Arrow Park rests with Arrow Park and its management. The Fire Rescue Authority is not responsible for that. We are responsible for making emergency responses across all of Merseyside, as you know, under the any premises such as hospitals, it is their responsibility to manage fire safety. The bottom line is, it is an extremely well-managed site. It has dedicated fire safety staff. It has an extensive automatic fire detection system. There's virtually no prospect that a fire would occur there and not be detected almost immediately, and that we would be notified immediately thereafter. As members are only too well aware, that unfortunately does not happen in domestic dwellings. That's where the risk is, members, and that is where people die, as again you are only too well aware. The longer attendance times to West Kirby and so West Kirby, Hoylake and the surrounding areas suggested that that would be acceptable because they are within national guidelines. To be clear, members, and as you're well aware, there are no national standards of fire cover. They were repealed back in 2004. The only extent, I suppose, anything you could refer to as vaguely resemble the national guidelines is the Integrated Risk Management Planning Guidance Note, which was issued back in 2004. And the text in italics on the bottom of page 82 across to 83, that sets out the hierarchy, if you like, of priority. You see there that life risk quite blatantly is at the top of that hierarchy. But the fundamental element, the fundamental tenet here within that guidance is that all sections of society should be served fairly and equitably, which of course is the fundamental tenet of the proposal. And just to make the point that the reduction of loss of life quite rightly and understandably occupies a more prominent position in the hierarchy than safeguarding their market. The comments made about the reductions of numbers of incidents which has occurred across both stationary and the fact that there is a higher volume of incidents in Upton. To be absolutely clear, members, the volume of incidents for the fire rescue service period is low. The way to describe this is the number of incidents, rather, Upton is just less quiet than West Kirby. But actually, in terms of life risk incidents, thankfully life risk incidents are very low in both of the areas. The fact is, the likelihood may be low, the severity is high, because the outcome ultimately is death, is it not? So if you take simplistic risk assessment methodology, likelihood 1, severity 5, for both of the areas, you are into you have an equal score across the two. And just on that point, members, in general terms, the Fire and Rescue Service, our activity levels will always, you would hope, be lower, certainly, than that of the Ambulance Service or the police, because quite frankly, if they weren't, and I have made this point before, there'd be nothing left at Merseyside, would there? Because it would all have burned down,
exactly.
All the cars would have crashed. Or, yeah. We will never have the same number, we'll never have the volume of incidents as the or the Ambulance Service. The issue was raised about increasing, if you move in the station 2 minutes one way, it increases response times by 2 minutes from the gate away from where you move in the station. To be clear, members, Sawgall Massey Road is on Upton station area. Okay, it is falls somewhere short of the midpoint between the two station areas. So in effect, what it's doing is it is moving it nearer to areas on Upton station areas, such as Sullivan, Massey, such as Morton, parts of Greasby, parts of Fanby. It's true to say it is moving it away from areas such as Woodchurch, but the fact is the average response back to those areas is still around 5 minutes, which is still quicker than the Merseyside region. It's as quick as anywhere else in the country. The analogy I would use is it is moving from an extremely fast response time in those areas to a very fast response time. Accepting, members, there's nothing we can do here that's not going to have an overall detrimental impact, simply because you can't if you are reducing the overall number of resources. And the final point to make is there were several references made to Thingwall area and Pensby that suggesting that they would be negatively affected by the planning application. Just to make the point, all three of those areas are on Heswell station area, they're not on the Upton station area, therefore their first response is unaffected by the proposal. The reasons for the refusal of the application set out at paragraph 26, the options open to the authority set out at paragraphs 28 to 30. Which I'll just refer to briefly, if you'll indulge me. The first is we would accept the decision of the planning committee, which would result then in the outright closure of West Kirby. Undoubtedly, that would be, and indeed would always have been, a far easier option, as we know from our experience with Allerton members, quite depressingly, it is far easier to close a fire station than it is to build one. That's for sure. We have found that out, as I say, with our experiences over in the will. But if I can just frame up the logic of the operational logic of the planning committee decision would be, you play that out across will. In order to make the financial savings required for the remainder of the spending review, what we would do is you'd close Heswell, Birkenhead and Wallasey, and you'd operate from Upton and Byrom, the key stations on the Will, because that would give you a theoretical 10-minute response on 90% of occasions. That is what the impact, you played that out across world, that's what that would look like. Now you might argue that's localism, and you might want to consider that, members, when it comes to the IRMP setup. But I have to say to you, I will never recommend that to you. But you need to bear that in mind. That's what that would look like. And I do not believe that that's what the residents, well, absolutely know that that is not what the overwhelming majority of the residents of Wirral support. Because we saw from the public consultation, aside from what is a very small and vocal minority of individuals opposing this, the vast majority of people on the Wirral absolutely recognise the logic. And actually, not that I have any interest in sort of social media type engagements, but actually the majority of social media shows that as well. Because we have our comms team who have an interest in such things. The other options, members, and say these aren't mutually exclusive, is we can submit a revised planning application which addressed the reasons for refusal and or the appeal to the Secretary of State. At the same time, officers are looking to pursue both of those options, clearly, because we have a mandate from yourselves. This is your policy decision to deliver this merge, and clearly, unless you resolve to the contrary, that's what we will continue to do. Conclude the report, members, which I felt was probably important to do so, is to set out the implications of the refusal of planning permission. Because actually this is the fundamental tenet of the whole proposal, and indeed if we accept significantly extended response times in West Kirby, then quite frankly you've lost your argument for them anywhere else on Merseyside, and that's a fact. So again, if you'll indulge me, I need to set these points out because you need to understand what the implications are potentially of the decision of the planning committee if we are not able to if we're not able to address that. So paragraphs 32, members, through to 43 is where I will make reference to them. So I will be as brief as I can, but I do think it's important to set this out. So as you're only too well aware, the background of the application is that this option does reduce it results in the least impact on response times. Accepting this, there is nothing we can do that doesn't affect response overall. So you know that we can no longer crew West Kirby and Upton. You know all the reasons for that. I won't go into that in any further detail. I've already made the point about the severity of incidents, the likelihood being low, thankfully, everywhere, severity being high. Make the point of paragraph 33, that was demonstrated tragically in the double fatality in West Kirby last year. So these things happen clearly, and they will continue to happen. I will return to that point a little bit later on in the report. You know that the average response times will increase significantly if we're able to relocate Upton. And what we'll have as members is you will be having response times when you include the call handling time that actually is the average in around 10 minutes, which is nearly twice the Merseyside average. That is far too long. It is far too long. I've already explained that Solo Massey is located on the current Upton station area, so I've explained what the impact does not, it is not that negative on Upton, as I say, using the analogy. Say that it would result in very fast response times rather than extremely fast to Upton. Substantive issues here though, members, is from paragraph 37. So all of the available research identifies that there is a relationship between survivability and response times. Actually, that would probably be self-evident to anyone. I'm not sure you would need to undertake significant academic research to establish that. So express simply, the faster that we can arrive at an incident intervene, the greater likelihood of survivability. Survivability, certainly in fire terms, decreases significantly beyond 10 minutes, as I've stated previously, as parts of West Derby and Hoyland that we can't reach now in 10 minutes, which means the averages to the areas we can are right up by 10 minutes, which again is twice the Merseyside average. As you know, we adopted the 10-minute response standard in 2013 as a direct result of the ongoing cuts to the budget. But to be clear, members, in no way, and I made the point at the time, was our aspiration to take 10 minutes to get anywhere. You know this. We've done all we can to maintain average responses much closer to where our historic 5 minutes performance is what we've delivered over time. The unfortunate reality is, members, though, that whatever we do here, incidents are going to occur, indeed will continue to occur all across Merseyside, that are going to result in fatalities, and that includes on the existing West Kirby station area. The point here is, and again, I will conclude on this point, but I do have to make it, every fatality is subject to an inquest which is presided over by a coroner. When a coroner's determine the reasons for the fatality, they consider facts. They don't consider uninformed rhetoric, sensationalism, or the advancement of factual inaccuracy. They absolutely do not consider that. And that was evidenced during the inquest into the double fatality that I referred to earlier on when speaking to this report. And I know this because I personally had to deal with the coroner, we had to deal with the families as well. Okay, we have to do that. There will be circumstances where the fatality is in the room of origin, and therefore they're going to be very unlikely to be able to escape. And in those circumstances, to be honest with you, members, our response times aren't going to have that great an impact on survivability. But there will absolutely be circumstances, and I can already, you know, I can point to incidents already where this has occurred, where it absolutely will make a significant difference to the outcome. And again, that will be self-evident to you all. Now, a coroner has wide-ranging powers, and one such power is to make recommendations over preventable deaths under Regulation 28. It's my view that we need to do all we can do to demonstrate that we've made every attempt to achieve the fastest response times that we possibly can in circumstances. Because we're going to have to demonstrate that to a coroner, because that is absolutely something that's going to be asked of us, because this is going to, when this occurs, and it's going to occur, then we need to be in a position to defend, if you like, the steps that we've taken to try to prevent the fatality. But in truth, all that aside, whatever that we have to defend to a coroner, the bottom line here is, and to go back to the point I made earlier, well, we have to deal with the families. And what we absolutely need to be able to do is to say to them, we did all we could here. Right? And for that reason, members, that's why we absolutely have to continue with this. And as I say, I am speaking from personal experience here, and on behalf of officers as well, who have to do this. And I've got to say, it's really not a thoroughly unpleasant, tragic thing to have to do. So I need to make that point. Before I conclude, members, need to draw your attention to the financial implications, which are set out at paragraphs 50 to 53, which is on pages 87 to 88. Now, as you'll see, members, there is a cost to an appeal, potentially up to in the order of £50,000, and there will be a cost to submit a revised application that's potentially in the order of £56,000. So you take the two together, you're potentially up to £100,000. And my personal view is there is no way this application should have been refused, but the fact of the matter is it was, which means we now have to incur further costs, potentially in the order of £100,000, to incur what we all, or rather to deliver what we know is the best outcome for public safety. Now, clearly, members, if it is your intention now, you can directly not to do that, but my view is, for all of the reasons that we've set out, that we absolutely have to do that. Pause at that point and take any questions you might have.
Very helpful. Very helpful.
Thanks, Steve. That was a good session. We'll ask questions now, so Sharon.
It's not so much of a question, it's a summing up of how we've arrived at this point. And I think everybody needs to be aware in this room, no matter what political party that they belong to, that we wouldn't be cutting anything or looking at reconfiguring or rebuilding anything or cutting pumps down from 40 out to 28, only because of the government cuts. Now here we are now at this juncture where we're looking at another £100,000 here. That's fallen on us as an authority. £100,000 that we haven't got. And I think common sense should prevail. And I think, Chief, there should be some way of us getting this money back. And I tell you what, every second counts when you're in a fire. Yeah. And I'm not interested whether the crested larva bird lives in sorghum nasty. The point is, if you've got a house with three babies in or anyone else in on fire, my God, what's the matter with them? They're so snobby. If you don't want to have a fire station, a fire station makes your own area where you live safer. Never mind anything else. You should reconsider. Just hold your heads in shame, really, that this is being knocked back. And consider the people in West Kirby and in Upton. You may not be as well off as you lot over on the other side, but my God, what a way to conduct yourselves. Thanks, Chief.
Chair, I think it's unfortunate really that the comments that Councillor Sullivan is making in such a tone really, because I think it's disparaging on residents particularly. I come from this from a point of view, and I did say it when it first came to this authority. I've had no involvement at all in this process as far as we're is concerned. I've purely looked at it as a member, and I am a Conservative, and it is a government of my colour. And I don't want this to sound like a bleeding heart case or something, but I don't know how many people around this table have actually held somebody whose life is ebbing away. I've done that in a previous occupation in a blue light organisation, and the only way that I've been able to go home that night is to say, was there anything else we could have done? I do know that that's something I wrote it down because the chief actually said that we did all that we could. And that's where I come from in this particular issue. And my actual stance is exactly as it was at the time. And as I say, I've had no part in the application as far as rural council's concerned. But I don't think it helps by us starting to call one community against another. We are the Merseyside community. We are, as an authority, trying to do the best we can for all of Merseyside, irrespective of wealth, of poverty, or perceived wealth or poverty. I don't think that those actual comments help. But I think for the 26,000 people,